The Doors of Perception, written by Aldous Huxley, narrated by Aedemon Maure. About the author, Aldous Huxley, A Life of the Mind. Poet, playwright, novelist, short story writer, travel writer, essayist, critic, philosopher, mystic, and social prophet, Aldous Huxley was one of the most accomplished and influential English literary figures of the mid-20th century. In the course of an extraordinary prolific writing career, which began in the early 1920s and continued until his death in 1963, Huxley underwent a remarkable process of self-transformation from a derisive satirist of England's chattering classes to a deeply religious writer preoccupied with the human capacity for spiritual transcendence. Yet in everything Huxley wrote, from the most frivolous to the most profound, there runs the common thread of his search to explain the meaning and possibilities of human life and perception. Aldous Huxley was born in Surrey, England, in 1894, the son of Leonard Huxley, editor of the prestigious Cornhill magazine, and of Julia Arnold, niece of the poet and essayist Matthew Arnold, and sister of Mrs. Humphrey Ward. He was the grandson of T.H. Huxley, the scientist. Thus, by birth and disposition, as one biographer put it, Huxley belonged to England's intellectual aristocracy. As Sybille Bedford writes in her fascinating biography, Aldous Huxley, Alfred A. Knopf, Harper and Row, 1974. What we know about him as a young child is the usual residue of anecdote and snapshot. During his first years, his head was proportionately enormous, so that he could not walk till he was two because he was apt to topple over. We put father's hat on him and it fitted. In another country, at a great distance in time and place, when he lay ill and near his end in Southern California, a friend wanting to distract him said, "Aldous, didn't you ever have a nickname when you were small?" And Aldous, who hardly ever talked about his childhood or indeed about himself, possibly because one did not ask, said promptly, "They called me OG, short for ogre." The ogre was a pretty little boy. The photographs show the high forehead, the then clear gaze, the tremulous mouth and a sweetness of expression, an alertness beyond that of other angelic little boys looking into a camera. Aldous, his brother Julian tells us, sat quietly a good deal of the time, contemplating the strangeness of things. "I used to watch him with a pencil," said his cousin and contemporary Jervis Huxley. "You see, he was always drawing. My earliest memory of him is sitting, absorbed. To me it was magic, a little boy of my own age drawing so beautifully. He was delicate. He had mischievous moods. He could play. He carried his rag doll about him for company until he was eight. He was fond of grumbling. They gave him a milk mug which bore the inscription, 'Oh, isn't the world extremely flat, with nothing whatever to grumble at?'" And Aldous, age six, being taken with all the Huxleys to the unveiling of the statue of his grandfather at the Natural History Museum by the Prince of Wales, and his mother trying in urgent whispers to persuade Julian, then a young Etonian, to give up his top hat, a very young Etonian and a very new top hat, to Aldous, queasy, overcome, to be sick in. When Huxley was a 16-year-old student at Eton, he contracted a disease that left him almost totally blind for 2 years and seriously impaired his vision for years to come. "The loss of sight was an event," Huxley later wrote, "which prevented me from becoming a complete public school English gentleman. It also ended his early dreams of becoming a doctor. Yet, in a curious way, though he abandoned science for literature, Huxley's outlook remained essentially scientific. As his brother, the zoologist Julian Huxley, wrote, science and mysticism were overlapping and complementary realms in Aldous Huxley's mind. The more science discovers, and the more comprehension it gives us of the mechanisms of existence, the more clearly does the mystery of existence itself stand out." Huxley took his undergraduate degree in literature at Balliol College, Oxford, in 1916, and spent several years during World War I working in a government office. After teaching briefly at Eton, he launched his career as a professional writer in 1920 by taking a job as a drama critic for the Westminster Gazette and a staff writer for House and Garden and Vogue. Possessed of seemingly infinite literary energy, he wrote poetry, essays, and fiction in his spare time, publishing his first novel, Chrome Yellow, in 1921. This bright, sharp, mildly shocking satire of upper-class artists won Huxley an immediate reputation as a dangerous wit. He swiftly composed several more novels in a similar vein, including Antic Hay, 1923, and Those Barren Leaves, 1925. In Point Counterpoint, 1928, considered by many critics his strongest novel, Huxley broke new ground, both stylistically and thematically. In a narrative that jumps abruptly from scene to scene and character to character, Huxley confronts modern man's disillusionment with religion, art, sex, and politics. The character Philip Qualls, a novelist intent on transforming a detached intellectual skepticism into a way of harmonious all-round living, is the closest Huxley came to painting his own portrait in fiction. Brave New World, 1932, though less experimental in style than Point Counterpoint, is more radical in its pessimistic view of human nature. Huxley's anti-utopia, with its eerie combination of totalitarian government and ubiquitous feel-good drugs and sex, disturbed many readers of his day. But it has proven to be his most enduring and influential work. During the 1930s, Huxley turned increasingly toward an exploration of fundamental questions of philosophy, sociology, politics, and ethics. In his 1936 novel, Eyeless in Gaza, he wrote of a man's transformation from cynic to mystic, and as war threatened Europe once again, he allied himself with the pacifist movement and began lecturing widely on peace and internationalism. For a number of years, Huxley lived in Italy, where he formed a close relationship with D.H. Lawrence, whose letters he edited in 1933. In 1937, Huxley and his Belgian-born wife, Maria Nice, and their son, Matthew, left Europe to live in Southern California for the rest of his life. Maria Huxley died of cancer in 1955, and the following year Huxley married the Italian violinist and psychotherapist Laura Archera. In the 1940s and 1950s, Huxley changed direction yet again as he became fascinated by the spiritual life, in particular with the possibility of direct communication between people and the divinity. Huxley read widely in the writings of the mystics and assembled an anthology of mystical writing called The Perennial Philosophy, 1945. Around this time, he began experimenting with mind-altering drugs like mescaline and LSD, which he came to believe gave users essentially the same experiences that mystics attained through fasting, prayer, and meditation. The Doors of Perception, 1954, and Heaven and Hell, 1956, Huxley's books about the effects of what he termed psychedelic drugs became essential texts for the counterculture during the 1960s. Yet Huxley's brother Julian cautions against the image of Aldous as a kind of spiritual godfather to hippies. One of Aldous's major preoccupations was how to achieve self-transcendence while yet remaining a committed social being, how to escape from the prison bars of self and the pressures of here and now into realms of pure goodness and pure enjoyment. Huxley pursued his quest for pure goodness and pure enjoyment right up to the end of his life on November 22, 1963. Today he is remembered as one of the great explorers of 20th century literature, a writer who continually reinvented himself as he pushed his way deeper and deeper into the mysteries of human consciousness. About the book, Drugs That Shape Men's Minds, an essay by Aldous Huxley. In the course of history, many more people have died for their drink and their dope than have died for their religion or their country. The craving for ethyl alcohol and the opiates has been stronger in these millions than the love of God, of home, of children, even of life. Their cry was not for liberty or death, it was for death preceded by enslavement. There is a paradox here, and a mystery. Why should such multitudes of men and women be so ready to sacrifice themselves for a cause so utterly hopeless, and in ways so painful and so profoundly humiliating? To this riddle there is, of course, no simple or single answer. Human beings are immensely complicated creatures, living simultaneously in a half dozen different worlds. Each individual is unique and in a number of respects, unlike all the other members of the species. None of our motives is unmixed, none of our actions can be traced back to a single source, and in any group we care to study, behavior patterns that are observably similar may be the result of many constellations of dissimilar causes. Thus, there are some alcoholics who seem to have been biochemically predestined to alcoholism. Among rats, as Professor Roger Williams of the University of Texas has shown, some are born drunkards, Some are born teetotalers and will never touch the stuff. Other alcoholics have been foredoomed not by some inherited defect in their biochemical makeup, but by their neurotic reactions to distressing events in their childhood or adolescence. Again, others embark upon their course of slow suicide as a result of mere imitation and good fellowship, because they have made such an excellent adjustment to their group. A process which, if the group happens to be criminal, idiotic, or merely ignorant, can bring only disaster to the well-adjusted individual. Nor must we forget that large class of addicts who have taken to drugs or drink in order to escape from physical pain. Aspirin, let us remember, is a very recent invention. Until late in the Victorian era, poppy and mandragora, along with henbane and ethyl alcohol, were the only pain relievers available to civilized man. Toothache, arthritis, and neuralgia could, and frequently did, drive men and women to become opium addicts. De Quincey, for example, first resorted to opium in order to relieve excruciating rheumatic pains of the head. He swallowed his poppy, and an hour later, what a resurrection from the lowest depths of the inner spirit, what an apocalypse. And it was not merely that he felt no more pain. This negative effect was swallowed up in the immensity of those positive effects which had opened up before me, in the abyss of divine enjoyment thus suddenly revealed. Here was the secret of happiness, about which the philosophers had disputed for so many ages, at once discovered. Resurrection, apocalypse, divine enjoyment, happiness. De Quincey's words lead us to the very heart of our paradoxical mystery. The problem of drug addiction and excessive drinking is not merely a matter of chemistry and psychopathology, of relief from pain and conformity with a bad society. It is also a problem in metaphysics, a problem, one might almost say, in theology. In the varieties of religious experience, William James has touched on these metaphysical aspects of addiction. The sway of alcohol over mankind is unquestionably due to its power to stimulate the mystical faculties in human nature, usually crushed to earth by the cold facts and dry criticisms of the sober hour. Sobriety diminishes, discriminates and says no. Drunkenness expands, unites and says yes. It is in fact the great exciter of the yes function in man. It brings its votary from the chill periphery of things into the radiant core. It makes him for the moment one with truth. Not through mere perversity do men run after it. To the poor and the unlettered it stands in the place of symphony concerts and literature, and it is part of the deeper mystery and tragedy of life that whiffs and gleams of something that we immediately recognize as excellent should be vouchsafed to so many of us only through the fleeting earlier phases of what, in its totality, is so degrading a poison.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.